Have you ever thought about having helium?
We do. We have that in the room over there. Oh. The helium tank. That's how we feature vocalists come in and record. They take a hit of the helium. That's how they do that future bass. Like, you know, I used to think it was just sampling that you would pitch it up.
Yeah,
but it's actually your artists just do helium first, and then they come in.
It's a brilliant idea.
Yeah, so I guess
I think helium stocks actually went up from that, from the
totally,
rise of future bass.
I think that would be good. We were just talking about the dentist idea. He had a genius idea that we just saw. Nick, you can actually chime in if you want. I don't know how you feel about the dentist. By the way, Atlanta, I am looking for a dentist. I haven't been to the dentist since I moved here. And if you could please link someone in the comments, some dentist, I would really appreciate that. I prefer someone that doesn't hurt. Maybe a female. I've had female dentists in the past. They seem really, gentle. But I know this is a great way to start a music podcast talking about dentistry. But the reason why we talked about it is because we're talking about technology for music. And he had this cool idea to put VR goggles on while you're in the dentist chair and, you know, go off and while they're doing work on you, you could be wherever you want. And then that's actually being done. I think you saw, right?
Yeah. My friend Mandy, she's a dentist in Vegas, and she's a super huge music fan as well. And she was, you know, we were just joking around about her opening up her own office. And I was like, well, you know, you can probably give the patients something to do while they're sitting down, like listen to music and have some sort of experience. So maybe, you know, build some speakers and the chairs or something and call it Beats and Teeth. And then I'm like, well, what if you even did VR and just gave them a whole VR experience while they're getting, you know, worked on? I don't know. I guess it depends on what you're experiencing in VR. If you're not playing like a horror game or something like that and getting, you know, chased by zombies.
Yeah, if it was me, I would probably just probably broadcast like the roof of the dentist office, I guess, would be like the best thing.
Yeah. Oh, so then, yeah, and then she actually just texted me a couple hours ago and saying that they are actually doing it. They are actually doing VR experiences while you're getting worked on, which is kind of cool.
That is pretty cool. What's cooler than that is I have Cazztek in the motherfucking studio
now.
So, ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't heard of this guy, he is a bass house boss. He does all kinds. What do you categorize yourself? Where do you fall in the genre spectrum?
It's actually kind of hard to really define where I fall into. Bass house, tech house. I think just the pulse of house music is what, you know, I grew up with and what inspires me. So, you know, I'd say my stuff is influenced by hip hop and funk and soul, and it just has everything in it. And when I write music, I'm not trying to write a tech house track. I'm not trying to write a bass house track. I'm just letting my ideas flow, and whatever flows down, you know, that's that's what it evolves into, that category, or, you know, what, however you want to identify it as.
Yeah, basically you're doing you in the moment, what you enjoy doing, so that it makes the studio a lot of fun, and then you have a really good product that you're proud of.
And you have a product that's unique to itself. You're not trying to fall into a, you know, an outline of something else that you're trying to reference. You know, once you get used to that, you just let your ideas flow, and you let those ideas flow into a template of, you know, your own arrangement. But then that becomes unique to identifying you as an artist. Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's why some of my music, you know, people tell me that they even say that I don't even know how to categorize you. And then I have people from multiple genres dropping my music because it crosses over, you know, to other genres. And the most important part is that they say that it's just a really good song and it brings on, you know, that the emotion that makes you happy or whatever it makes you feel at that time. And I think that's what's more important, you know.
Totally. Yeah, and your branding is killer. So this is Cazztek, the artist formerly known as Revolver, and you are a badass as Revolver too, and now you have formed into even more of this badass. I'm just gonna say bass house, just because like I noticed the bass in your track just sounds real nice. So.
It definitely has a undertone of of bass design.
It's very good. Yeah. But yeah, so I actually saw a picture of you like 10 years ago versus what you're looking like now, and it's like quite the pretty interesting transformation there, and from the DJ from your start. And you're just talking about where you kind of came from house music. Like, where did you actually grow up? Like, take me back to like first grade. Like, what was your musical journey like?
My musical journey was the 90s growing up. And I grew up with a lot of the 90s hip hop, 90s R&B, all that. Even, 90s R. Kelly. Of course I didn't know what I wanted to do at the time, but I always loved music. I mean, I was beatboxing as a kid, and I had just collections of music. And even, when my family traveled, I had my Walkman with me, or CD, the CD Walkmans, you remember those?
Yeah, yeah.
Had that with me.
It would always skip too. You could never go for a run with that thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? Go for a quick run, you like tuck it in your like your belt. Yeah, it never.
You just have to be careful. Yeah, they didn't even work.
Yeah, no.
That shock absorption. No one will know.
Now you got your whole cloud playlist on your watch with your wireless earbuds, and you can do whatever you want. It's pretty.
I know.
Pretty cool.
So yeah, I was always into music, and I was always into wanting to know how that music was made. I just had this, even as a kid, I wanted to just know, like, oh, what was that? What's that instrument? Or how is that part being sung? Or, how are they rapping that way or whatever? So I think in high school, I think my graduating year, I kind of...
Where'd you go to high school?
Up in the Bay Area, like Northgate. That's what it's called. It's super suburbs.
Do you have a gang sign? Like an N and a G.
I have like an opposite anti gang sign in the freaking suburbs. But I got, so that was the Bay Area, and I fell into the rave scene in the Bay Area, San Francisco, Oakland. That's when all the warehouse parties were happening. So then I got into that and bought my first pair of turntables, and I fell in love with house music because that's what I heard for the first time. And I wanted to be a DJ or not even want to be a DJ. I was just so, just curious about it that I wanted to learn how to do it. So I did that.
So and you then, just did that. I mean, I just, you can't just gloss over.
Well, I went to Guitar Center. I bought the beginner's kit or whatever you call it in a box,
DJ in a box.
Yeah, the Newmark, the belt drive tables.
Yeah.
Like, they were horrible. I mean, honestly, it took like a good 5 seconds for it to go from, stop to go. But it probably made me a better DJ.
So you were producing the music first?
No. So, well, I guess now that I really think about it, in high school, I got into editing music with just basic editing software like SoundForge. I was part of a dance crew. So in high school.
I was going to ask.
So,
crew or like
So in high school.
Tap dancing crew.
In high school. Instead of get a PE, you would have the option to be part of dance production. And every guy wanted to be on there because it had all the hottest girls, dude. Like you should have seen the auditions. It was like, three guys to every girl. And of course I made it, I got moves. So I used to be a break dancer. And
me
so,
too. We got to talk about
dude.
That.
Hell yeah. Okay.
That's how I got into DJing too. That's great.
That's awesome. Yeah. So, got into that, and what we would do is put a show together at the end of the year. It was really cool. It was really a nice way to push creativity on these high school kids. And we would create a whole show ourselves at the end of the year, and do all the music and all that stuff. And what the kids were doing is what they were doing editing on their cassette tapes. So I was like, well, I have a computer at home, and I have a CD-ROM. And I can actually edit music. And so that's how I kind of, all of it started happening, because I installed that and I got into editing music. And with the music that I listened to, I would always want to hear it a certain way, like a different way than it was produced. So I would like cut the bridge out or, you know,
kind of
rearrange it and enjoy the music that way. So that's how I got into it. And then, so technically, I guess I was sort of producing before DJing, but not really.
You know? And producing like a DJ, you know, you're making like kind of DJ edits at that point.
I guess, but I didn't know it. I just wanted to hear music in a different way, right? So, yeah, and so, you know, I DJed for a while and just got into it and, you know, house parties with all the friends and college and stuff. And I kind of got bored with it. Well, not bored, but I wanted to be challenged even more. So I was like, okay, well, how do I make this? How do I compose it? And so I got into that and I got into music production, and that's how it led into that. And the community college that I was going to at the time, they put a whole bunch of money into a new program called Making Music with Computers.
Mm.
And so I,
cool.
And you could use it as an elective. So I, you know, I took some of those classes and I just totally fell in love with it. They were teaching Logic, and I became obsessed with the class. And you'd have to use, you know, after school lab hours to use the studio. I mean, they had vocal booths, everything. I mean, it was actually pretty cool. And so I did so well in the class that the teacher was like, oh, well, do you want to be a tutor for our classes? And so I said, yeah. And he said, so you can use the studio anytime you want. So that's sick. Kind of like how I fell into it. Yeah.
So just what version of Logic was it at that time? Like six?
Oh man, I don't even remember. Yeah, seven. Something like that.
I started on Logic too, and I am assuming you have since moved on to Ableton.
I'd have, yeah, I have.
Why did you switch, and when did you switch?
So let's see here. I switched, I don't even remember. I'd probably say 2011, 2012, so yeah, 8 years ago.
And why?
Because I was talking shit on it, on Ableton. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I might cool the cuss.
Yeah.
Cool.
Shit.
Yeah, dirty words.
Motherfucking Logic.
Cunt. All right.
Sounds
cool.
Better than Ableton. And he was like, yeah, Ableton sucks. And then he was like, wait, Ableton is actually cool.
Yeah. So I talked
shit.
By
the way, if you are someone who has no idea about what we're talking about right now and you're just tuning in to the Liquified podcast for the first time, Ableton is a computer software program that a lot of DJs use to make music. It's great. I use it. My mom uses it. Anyone who makes electronic music. Well, I don't want to say that at all, actually, because there's all kinds of other shit. But thanks for tuning into the show. We don't always talk about music stuff. We might talk about the dentist later. But for now, I'm really interested to know why Cazztek switched over to Ableton. Do you even use Logic anymore at all?
Hell no.
Okay.
I talk shit on Ableton and everyone's like, oh, well, some, you know, my friends that were avid Ableton users, they're like, well, you can't say anything until you actually make a track with it. And I was like, all right, fine, deal. I think the reason why I was so against it was because the first time I opened it was, and I was trying to figure it out, it was just alien language to me. It went against the grain, with everything else that was out there with, you know, Pro Tools, Logic, Cubase, they all followed the same kind of linear workflow. And Ableton went against all of that. So when I tried to first mess with it, I just couldn't figure it out. And I was like, oh, this sucks. So I took a month to learn. Took the challenge and took like a month to get over the learning curve of using it and making my first track on it. And I did. And I seriously haven't looked back since. It finally clicked with me, the reason why they designed it the way they do. And it's really
the creative process.
It really embraces the creative process, and it's like it's as if you're holding a paintbrush and you're just going, you know, painting what you want to paint. I didn't have that with Logic. It's very, I guess, programmatic. You have to, you know, do all these steps to get the results that you want to get. With Ableton, it's so just, oh, just drag this here and just drag that there. And you can, you know, you can perform stuff live and loop it and this and that. And you can build and build. And it's just so intuitive. You know?
So what does kind of your creative process look like at this point?
In terms of just writing?
In terms of like, how do you get in the zone to sit down and do a track? Like, do you need to have all your errands done, or do you need to, does it need to be 3 a.m. and you're like wasted, or do you, does it need to be like in your own studio, or can you do it on the road, or do you start with a bass line, or like?
Yeah, I think it can happen. It can happen anywhere. You know, the ideas that you download, you just can't predict them. I mean, stuff comes to me right before I go to bed, and it's the worst thing because literally every time I'm like, oh, this is such a sick beat. I'm just, I'm totally going to remember this in the morning. Oh, I, how can you forget a beat like this? Yeah. I'm totally going to remember this. Of course, the next morning I'm like, what?
Yeah.
What happened?
That's like a Mitch. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. So and as far as like writing music, I can, it starts anywhere. I mean, I could start from just a melody to just playing around with, you know, saxophone samples or, you know, a funky bass line, or even just an actual drum beat, and then, you know, adding on top of that. From the experience that I have, I don't really have a method of trying to come up with ideas. It just kind of happens. Mm-hmm. And then it's almost like a river, like it's like an imaginary river in a different dimension. And it's just, you know, you're connected to it somehow. And there are occasions where your mind connects to it and you're like, what? And, it's like you're fishing for it and it comes by and you're like, whoa. And you got to grab onto it. You got to grab onto that idea and you got to reel it in. And then once you reel it in, you lay it down and you know, you do your thing.
I think there's some quantum theory involved with your creative process. I like it, dude. That's cool.
Yeah.
So, shit.
Well, there's a TED Talks. I don't know if you watch much of it.
Yeah, I do.
So have you seen the one where the woman's talking about your genius?
There's so many TED Talks nowadays. I can't even watch them all.
So she goes
like everyone's a genius.
So that everyone's a genius, and that it's this, your genius is a part of you, that is just always active. And when you come up or download amazing ideas, it comes from that genius. And what she was saying that is that some people, they show gratitude for, they don't take the credit for that idea. Mm. It comes from somewhere else, and you're blessed to be able to either capture it or translate it into, you know, reality. So, you know, I may have, you know, different geniuses of, you know, cool inventions and stuff, but I don't have the capability of turning that into a reality. But if it's music related, then I may have the ability to take that, you know, idea or whatever, right, and just like manifest.
So
that.
She's saying that, does she have a solution for being able to, you know, put your genius plan into action if you're unable to, or does she just,
you know,
leave it out there?
It's been a while since I've seen it, but I think she also went over that.
That would be kind of a bummer. She's like, everyone's a genius, but like, you really just can't be a genius.
Well, I guess I think it's also about shifting that mentality. You know, when you're like, oh, I came up with that idea or whatever, blah, 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 where it's like, dude, this amazing thing happened and I'm really grateful to be able to like, mm-hmm, to download that and turn it to an amazing idea. Like some of my, you know, best tracks, that's kind of the mentality I have. You know, it was just like that right time and the right moment where I was able to just grab that and then like, mm-hmm, lay it down, because it just comes at you.
Totally.
I mean, some of the, like, Came to Get Funky, some of the greatest tracks that I've written, it literally happened within minutes, sometimes even seconds, where it's just like, boom, oh my gosh, something clicked in my head and I just, mm-hmm, wrote it down and I was able to, and boom, there it is. Mm-hmm. And some people are scared that it'll, you know, it happens once and then they're scared that it'll never happen again. Mm-hmm.
So I'm about to ask the listeners that haven't heard your music before to go right now on Spotify or SoundCloud and listen to one of your songs. So if they could just hear one song of yours, which one would you want them to hear?
A lot of people already know my song Came to Get Funky, but if it was one song that I would tell them to go hear, it would be Crazy Things at Night, because I downloaded that song, I think, like in the middle of the night, and I actually woke up with it in my head, and it happened to me. I was like, oh, I can just remember this in the morning, and I stopped myself, and I was like, I actually need to just get up.
I did the same thing.
And just go.
And I have it on my hard drive, and it's called In a Dream. And it's
In a Dream?
It's just that's MIDI awesome. Right now that I'm going to title later. But I literally woke up and was like, I had this beat in my head. Speaking of, you made a song called Beats Inside My Head, which I think super needs a refresher.
Out. Maybe. But it's not my song.
Oh, you know, that's right. You remixed that, right? It. That's yeah. right. You remixed yeah. it. Well... Scooter and Lavelle, is it their song?
It is their song, yeah.
Scooter and Lavelle. Shit, I had Lavelle on my old show back in the day. I should have asked for that. Yeah, you guys go check out Beats Inside My Head by Scooter and Lavelle, Revolver Remix. Yeah, that one needs to come back. That was such a,
that was
catchy,
a catchy one. That
catchy,
was
catchy little vocal on that one yeah. right now. But Crazy Things at Night, so you just like woke up and kind of like, you know, you had this melody in your head, you wrote it mm-hmm. down.
Yep.
It does happen. It's interesting.
And it's a super weird beat, and mm-hmm. it's just out there if you listen to it. I don't know if you've heard it.
But I probably have. I think I've listened to all of your
it's
releases.
It's kind of like just weird.
I play your shit.
Super dark. Nice. Thanks.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank I you. Like your Like That song. I think that's probably.
Down Like That?
Yeah.
That's a fun one.
Yeah. Go. Yep. That's the one I say maybe go check out.
Yeah.
But he's got a lot of stuff, and he's got a lot of stuff in the works. And we were talking even before the mic started rolling. And this dude is just a master plan of like ideas. He's always thinking. Go follow his Instagram, his Facebook. All of his posts have some kind of substance and meaning. Like you'll never see him post a picture of like a roast beef sandwich he's about to eat and like with the quote like it's about to go down or some shit like that. Like he's always posting like real like pertinent type of stuff that, you know, I vibe with, which is why you probably pop up in my feed all the time, because I'm always liking your shit because you actually share good content. So I can appreciate that, because a lot of people, I don't think they understand that you don't have to share everything all the time. Like, I was, shout out to Liquified at the Green Velvet show last night, which, by the way, bonkers.
I heard that was awesome.
Oh, my God. You guys got to go to the district if you haven't been, and you got to see Green Velvet. But he destroyed that room. It was amazing. But I couldn't help but notice people don't have, well, not all people, just some people. They don't have a sense of, hey, you're in line at the grocery store right now. It's your turn to pay. You get off. You're like, why are you emailing your boss right now? Like, I saw so many yeah. people like walking straight, you know, and it was so crowded. District was like, there's no parking there. It was like the most packed I've ever seen it. And like, I saw this girl just walk. There's like 17 people behind her, like trying to go through. And she just stops and is just like staring, sucked into her phone. And it's like, come on, like,
right.
just get out of there and go to the corner and get on your phone. Sorry for that little rant, but she just made me
side
late.
Rant.
I wanted a drink. Yeah, shout out to District and shout out to the Housework guys for bringing Cazztek to Atlanta. We got big things popping off in Atlanta. We got the Super Bowl coming out next week. We have other big DJs coming through. We got Diplo and Tiesto playing the same weekend. Zed was supposed to play that weekend, but Zed had to pull out. I don't want to start talking rumors, but some real bad shit happened at one of the Atlanta clubs here. I don't want to talk anything bad. We already talked about it, so
yeah,
we'll leave that one alone. But yeah, good for you, Zed, for you know, I guess making the right call or whatever. But we'd like to see you back here, sir. And if there's anyone you guys want to see in the dance music world come to play some Liquified shows, write a little comment on who you'd like to see. We do mind control events that's more house oriented, and then we have other, you know, styles of music, anywhere from, you know, drum and bass to deep house to trap to whatever, man. So great music scene in general. Where do you see the music scene, like, because you play festivals and stuff, so where do you see technology evolving the scene that you find yourself in right now? Like, where is it in 5 years?
Where is it in 5 years? Are you talking about in terms of the style of music or like just different technological applications?
I'm talking about the production value of shows, and I'm talking about what's going to be popular. Maybe even throw some fashion things in there, because, you know, fashion is part of it too. You know, people used to wear big pants, now they wear skinny pants.
I'm just
going to
make scarves popular. that's the next big thing, is scarves.
Okay. Cazztek scarves.
Exactly.
Get them here.
I don't have a prediction of what kind of music will be popular. All I have a prediction of is, you know, me just writing what I love. Whether or not, you know, the masses want to follow that, I don't really think that's my concern. I think it's whoever wants to follow me with my journey and this, you know, the movement that I'm making, they're more than welcome to. And I completely welcome that. And I think that's just the attitude to have, you know?
Mm-hmm.
In terms of technology, there's one thing that I'm pretty excited about. It's very in its early stages, but it's something that's super cool. Have you heard of Dolby Atmos?
No. Nick, you have? Nick, say hey to everybody.
Hey.
There he is.
Hey.
Say it again.
Hey.
Hey. Are you doing?
What is Dolby Atmos?
Dolby Atmos is it's a format of surround sound that's used in movie theaters.
Oh, I have seen
that.
Yeah, I used to sell. Okay. Anyways, yeah. I'm an idiot. Yeah, I used to sell those.
You should know.
JBL. Bro. Come on. 7 series. Yeah.
Yeah. So, it's the I think it's a plus more anything, it has to do with more than 5 speakers, right? It's the surround their surrounding speakers and then the speakers above you. So it creates like a 3D sphere.
So can you produce tracks instead of like left and right? You can produce.
So
like 3D,
yeah. So the I think Dolby is the company. They just released a plugin that allows you to convert your music into Dolby Atmos. Have you seen it?
Yeah.
And I just think that's the freaking coolest thing ever. Yeah. And I'm so excited about it. And I'm really excited about producing music in the 3D atmosphere.
So you don't even really need one of those systems to listen to it.
Yes, you do. That's the thing. So that's why I feel like it's just in its early stages, because there's only 3 clubs in the world right now that have Dolby Atmos installed. I think one's in Europe, one's in San Francisco, Halcyon, and I don't know where the third one is.
Pioneer did that system, Halcyon. So
really?
Yeah, it must be a Dolby
maybe it is
Pioneer collab there. You don't need Dolby speakers, right? Dolby's just
I think it's the Dolby's the technology and just how it's encoded.
You ever heard of this there, Nick? Nick's a sound man.
A little bit. I did some post-production for the commercials, and there's one movie that we worked on. But yeah, we worked with Dolby Atmos for that. It was, I want to say like Crystal, like the burger chain had a commercial that had Atmos on it. I don't know why.
I went to Crystal since I've been back here to Atlanta. Subpar, Crystal. I used to Mac you down, and then I don't know if it was the night I went, but it wasn't what I remembered it
what
to
is
be.
It?
Crystal cheeseburgers, man. That's a southern thing, man. They got little like sliders
it's,
and shit.
Yeah, it's Southern White Castle.
Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. I got you.
I used to love it, but it was not good. But yeah, what do you eat on the road, man? I mean, sorry to bring up diet, but he just threw me a Crystal curveball. But I mean, when you're on the road traveling like you are now, do you stick to like a regime diet, or you just eat what the fuck ever?
I think it depends on the day. I think weekdays are my non-cheat days. Mm-hmm. And then
weekends you go.
I mean, I think I just try to eat healthy in general. A couple of years or a year ago, I did the ketogenic diet. I lost like 20 pounds. And I'm already kind of pretty fit. Mm-hmm. That was like the best shape I've ever been in.
I think I saw your dad comment on one of your pictures, like, hey, where'd your weight go? And you're like, I still got it, Dad.
And I'm like, don't worry, Dad.
Does your family support you pretty good?
Oh, yeah, for sure. Absolutely.
That's
yeah,
awesome.
I do. But, yeah, I tried that. That was interesting. I definitely, it was a challenge to, you know, be really disciplined and not eating any type of carb or sugar. But you definitely feel a shift in your overall vibe.
Was it for the better?
It was definitely for the better. I'd probably do it again. I wouldn't say I would do it permanently because I just love food too much.
So you got off of it because it was just too hard to maintain?
I was satisfied with my results. So I kind of just, you know, broke the rules and fell off.
Oh, yeah.
But I went paleo, which is it's the keto diet, but you can eat fruit as the sugar, but you can't eat sugar. So I've been kind of like, you know, into that a little bit. Mm-hmm. But I definitely cheated tonight because I ate a burger with a bun on it. So,
well, how many?
I'm a hypocrite.
How many alcoholic beverages is Cazztek gonna have for his set tonight?
I don't know. Just a couple.
I see you have like a really cool like persona, like puffing clouds. I love it.
Yeah.
What's in the vape, dude?
I like the
what's in the vape?
You would like to know, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Actually, it's CBD e-liquid.
Mm, and what flavor?
Yeah. It's a Kentucky Punch. That's what it's called.
Whoa, that sounds like a sex move. Where do you get this stuff?
I get it from this site called cbdonly.com. They're just this like a CBD superstore.
Cool.
And they have everything. Yeah, and you know, I've been into the kind of the vaping, you know, thing, and I wanted to at least take the healthy route for it, so I got the CBD.
Totally.
I kind of mix it. It's like a little mixture.
What are some CBD benefits of CBD? I hear that name tossed around a bit, but like, what's it good for?
So CBD, if anyone doesn't know, it's a part of the cannabis plant, right? I think there's a whole bunch of cannabinoids that are in the plant, like THC, CBD, CNN, ABC. it's like a broadcast network inside the plant, you know? And CBD is the one that provides a lot of medical benefits in terms of, I think, pain, inflammation, anxiety, a lot of things like that. So it kind of soothes the soul. Mm-hmm. when you ingest it. I like it. Kinda calls,
do you ever get anxiety before shows?
I get anxiety kind of just occasionally. I think it's just part of always wanting to
part of 2019
part of it's always part of 2019 and yeah, trying to be productive and handling a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, I think the world is experiencing an overwhelming amount of anxiety compared to what it was probably 30 years ago. I feel that. What gives you anxiety?
I don't know. I think it's just the thought of always needing to get the next thing done. Mm. Right.
That is,
and if I'm not
thing.
Getting anything done, I get anxiety. I'm just like, am I progressing?
Do you go through that?
Yeah. I mean, as projects come up, it's just tough. I mean, dealing with like due dates and cutoffs, and it's just as stuff piles up, it just gets more and more crazy. You know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. For sure. And I think that there's an existence. I'm just going to be open about this. There's an existence of alcoholism in my family. And, you know, they say it's genetic. And for me, I'm not addicted to anything at all. But then I question, am I addicted to work? Or is that why I'm not addicted to anything? Because I have music in my life and I have a way of creating in my life. And that is what kind of keeps me occupied. And then if I don't create, is that why I get anxiety?
I can say, you know? 100% the exact same statement that you just said, from the part where you said alcoholism runs in your family to where you just finished. That is identically me too. Yeah, I'm not really addicted to anything. I could, you know, in college I could just smoke a cigarette, I guess.
Yeah, me too. I can just have a cigarette every now and then. I'll be cool. I'm not fiend for it.
Yeah. Well, I am definitely addicted to music, and I listen to a lot of music, and your shit is always the best shit. Your shit is always super quality. Oh, thanks, man. And I'm happy to actually have met you in San Diego, kind of like before even, I guess we met through Revolver. I think we played some shows.
I think so, yeah.
That'll be a fun story. Do you remember, okay, we're on the subject of anxiety. You wouldn't even remember this, but we played a roller skating rink together 10 plus years ago for Brian Dyer.
Oh my God, yeah.
Okay, so okay, sure. I had to play after you, and you just destroyed the place, okay? And so I'm in the back with my, like, I'm like, oh shit, I have to follow this guy? Like, I'm really thinking that. And this was probably the most... It wasn't the biggest crowd I had played at the time, but it was the highest level of energy that I was about to have to go, like, keep up.
I remember that night.
Because you just slayed it down. And
that was a fun night.
You were, like, on Beatport, and you were real hot. And so I played after you. There's probably a picture we could put up in here of that. Actually, make a note. We're going to put that picture. Don't put it up. I'm just saying, like, put it for later. I want to add it into the feed. But... Brian comes back and he's like, hey, dude, are you ready to go? And like at that point, I had looked out because I was behind the curtain, and then I had looked out. I mean, there was like a bounce house like 200 yards in the back.
Yep, I remember
that. And the kids were just going crazy. It was absolutely a rave. And he's like, you ready to go? And I had looked up and I saw like what I was about to have to go do. And I kind of like started... I don't at all get stage fright before shows, because now I prepare for them, so I don't have to worry about when I'm actually playing. I already know what I'm going to do. I don't like arrange my tracks perfectly, but I know what I'm going to do. So,
yeah.
But at the time, I even kind of planned it out, but man, I had anxiety. And so you're playing your last song and everyone is like going crazy. I'm like shaking. I literally can't feel my hands. So I start like clapping above my head to your song, but it was to get feeling back in my hands. And so,
no way.
Yeah. And that was back before Jump Drive. So I had a book of CDs on the thing, and I'm opening up my CD to find one to put in the CD player. And I finally put it in. I can't remember if I mixed into your track. I think I did. I think I played a Wolfgang song, and I was like, it was like the perfect one. And it clicked, and all the anxiety like went away immediately. And then I just got into like party mode. And the thing that stands out to me the most about that show is that the stage was rocking so hard. I've told this story a lot, even on shows before, but the turntables were rocking so hard that the pitch bend, I couldn't use my fingers to adjust it enough. I literally held my hand stable so it would rock into my hand to move the pitch thing up.
What?
Yeah, to like adjust the pitch, I held it because the whole thing was just like coming down.
Yep.
But so that was a show. And then we played another show like probably 2 years later in San Bernardino. And this was a significant show too, because Brian bought brand new CDJ Pioneer Nexus turntables and a mixer. It was like $6,000. He goes in there, he opens up, and then it was going to be Stillwell, and then I played, and then it was you. And in the first song, Brian jumps up on the stage and tries to like jump off on the drop and kicks the whole setup over. Music stops.
Thing.
Music stops. CDJs break, and it's like, the kid at this rave, it was like, it was one of those weird parties where like the doors open and it's like there's no people filing in. It's like everyone's outside waiting to come
in.
Doors open, boom. It's like already like a party immediately. as soon as the music goes on. So he jumps off on like the first song on the drop, and the CDJs break, and like probably 20 minutes of us fidgeting around, like the link broke. So where you put the drive in, like they all link up, but so we had to like copy drives and like put them in all of them.
Brand new.
So he returned them. He's like, these things are broken, man. What the fuck, man? So he like exchanged them. But,
oh, man.
So yeah, dude. So ever since then, man, I've definitely have put the old Beatport follow on you, and your music is coming through and it's always fire. And so that's why it's cool that, you know, I got to, you know, that we're doing this right now, man. I think this is what you call full circle.
Yeah.
It's great to have you out here. And we did a show with another San Diego boy. Where were you living in San Diego when we were doing that?
I lived in kind of like the Claremont, Claremont area.
Yeah, so yeah. I interviewed Abe last night. Okay, at the, he played the Buckhead Theater, and he's a San Diego Chula Vista boy too. And he his music is super on point. So listeners, go check him out. You've probably already heard of him if you're listening to this podcast. But yeah, this is great stuff. So I'm excited to, you know, learn more about you and just watch your whole brand grow and you accomplish goals as an artist. I mean, you also just got engaged to Genesis, who also is a great producer and DJ, and her tracks are fire too. And how did you guys meet anyways?
Nikki Genesis and I met at a it was like a dive bar in San Diego. Well, not a dive bar. Do you know AC Lounge?
Oh yeah.
You know AC Lounge. Yeah. Shout out to AC Lounge for having us meet. But that's where we met. And a friend of mine asked me to play his night there. It was on a Wednesday, and I'm like, I just got back from tour, and I'm kind of like in my head, I'm like, are you kidding me, dude? And
Junior? Sorry. I thought he was the guy who was doing Wednesdays there.
No. Do you know Danny Pollock?
Yeah.
It's a Danny Pollock. It's cool. Danny Pollock.
Shout out, Danny.
Shout out to Danny.
Your stones are better.
So, he gets credit for that. Shout out. But, I was just playing music, and she had been dragged out by Stillwell and a bunch of friends, and I didn't meet her yet, and she didn't want to go out. I didn't want to go out, but then she heard the music that was playing, and she was like, "Whoa, this is dope! Like, mm-hmm. I need to find out who's playing."
Was and she from San Diego too?
Yeah, she's a San Diego native.
No shit.
Yeah, yeah. So she just, you know, she just came up to me and introduced herself to me, and cool. I was like, "That's it."
You're like, "Hey, baby, want to get married?"
She was like, "Hi, I'm Nikki Genesis," and I was like, "Oh, wow, I like that name." And the rest is history. And so because we met through music, I thought that it would be great to propose to her through music.
How'd you do it?
I did it on New Year's. A close friend threw a party, a New Year's party, and kind of built it around this occurrence. And I spent 2 months, just 2 months, learning how to play guitar and learning how to sing, and then practicing doing both of them so I could perform this song that I wanted to learn for her.
And you were able to do that in just two months?
2 months, yeah. So like the first 3 weeks I learned how to play guitar. The second 3 weeks I learned how to, I took vocal lessons. Wow. And then the last, you know, few weeks I would sneak away and practice doing both. And then I performed that for the first time in front of like 100 of our friends.
Whoa.
It was crazy.
So what was the song?
It was called, it was by
a
duo.
Will You Marry Me?
No.
By Cazztek?
It was by Angus and Julia Stone. God, what was it called? I don't know why I'm drawing a blank.
How did she know that that was a Will You Marry Me?
Well, because the chorus of it says, "You are the only one." Mm. And then I got on one knee afterwards.
Damn.
Yeah.
She doesn't seem like her traditional wedding ring type of girl. What kind of ring is she rocking?
I made the ring with a friend of ours that's a jeweler, Tim Meyer. And he's an amazing jeweler. And we spent about 6 months designing it. I gave him just a bunch of like cool shapes and like.
Did you pull that from the cloud?
Our tattoos. He did. And he just drew it, and then and we kind of just melted it all together, like all of our ideas. That was pretty cool.
Was it Draw Your Swords?
Draw Your Swords. That's what it was. Sorry, nice. I can't.
There, that's why we have you on the show, there, buddy.
Jeez, yeah, shame on me. Can you remember the freaking song I learned?
You should research Atlanta marijuana laws too. I want to get to know what that's all about here, because things have changed since the old move from where it's recreational to where you get fined.
So it's decriminalized, but that doesn't mean it's legal.
What is that?
Is it here?
So you?
Yeah, we're talking about here in Atlanta.
Yeah, so it is decriminalized, like medical.
No, it's not medical. You get a ticket if it's under an ounce, but if it's over an ounce, it's a felony.
Oh my God. From a plant that grows from the earth.
Yeah, so there are only a couple towns in Georgia that do that. So it's like Atlanta, Decatur, Tucker, and Clarkston, I think.
Yeah.
And everywhere else, any amount, paraphernalia, anything, you're going to jail.
That's
ridiculous. Damn. Well, write your local congressperson. I think Nick actually does that. Right, you are the type of character that actually goes out there and is proactive about law changing and like writing senators and shit, right?
Yeah, and honestly, the best way I'm gonna give him a shout out is ResistBot.
Yeah,
you text resist to 50409, and then you just type in Senate or Congress or whoever, and it'll find your congressperson. You type out your message, no matter how long it takes, and then it'll like tweet it at them. It'll fax it to them. Email them.
Maybe look at the memo to get with the times.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if it fits certain parameters, it'll like submit it to your local newspaper to try to get your letter posted. Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
Cool.
I can't believe that. It's just.
Well, thanks,
still,
Nick.
I can't believe it's still at that stage.
Nick. So you're getting married now then. I saw you guys take what looked like an early honeymoon.
Oh, yeah.
Because we did the same thing. I just got married this summer, and we went to Ibiza. Nice. We went to Barcelona and Italy, and I'll be damned. It was a great time. We saw some really great DJs. I love it that I fell in love with a beautiful woman that loves the music as much as I do. So she's, you know, she's just as into it, I guess. So I get to bring her along to shows and see shit. So. Yeah, did you guys, where all did you go? I saw a bunch of cool.
Well, I had an Australian tour, and so I found the opportunity to take Nikki with me and just go visit Bali while we're on the side of that planet. Anyways, nice. And just kind of make a trip out of it.
Did you make it to Brisbane?
I did. Australia. I played in Brisbane. That was one of the cities I played in.
Yeah, that's where my wife Joanna's dad lives.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so we went out there. That's where I proposed.
No way, really?
Yeah,
that's awesome. Brisbane, we went to the rainforest. Yeah. They have like 2 hours outside of that. Mm-hmm. So awesome.
Did you see any cool animals and that you could sample in your tunes? Did you go out there with a mic and sample real shit?
I should have.
Like a kookaburu. Punch him in the face and record it. And then you'd be like, Cazztek gets kookaburus to feature in his tracks. Man, this guy's on a whole nother level, bro.
Featuring kookaburu. I don't know. PETA might come after me and sue me for that. For copyright infringement.
Call that one nature. Kentucky Punch. That's his new feature or something. But how is Australia crowd? I mean, do you notice, like, does your music... I saw your Spotify post. It looks like you got a couple million plays. Congratulations on that. Thanks. Do you see your music more popular in other areas of the world?
Yeah, it's just... It's. I think it's kind of evenly spread out to, like, the top four. And then it kind of just tapers off. I think the top, obviously, is the U.S., Australia, the U.K., Canada, and Brazil.
Nice. Where is that first one that you mentioned, the U.S.? Where is that?
I don't know.
A terrible joke.
A couple miles
terrible jokes, people. Sometimes I try to say stuff that I shouldn't say. But but that's cool. Do you notice, like, the crowd reactions to your sets are better in other places, or does it all just depend on the festival or the show?
I think it depends on the atmosphere and the festival and the shows. Australia was definitely amazing. All of the shows were just fire. Everyone, the energy was just beyond, you know, just such a good time.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Chinese Laundry. I played Chinese Laundry. That was awesome. It's like a world famous club in Sydney.
Would you say that's, like, what are some of your top clubs? Was that one of your top clubs?
That was definitely, that was definitely a highlight, for sure. There was I played a DJ competition in Sydney as part of the tour, And I was one. I wasn't. I didn't compete. I was the guest. Okay. That, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I thought about competing.
Were they like scratching and shit, or was it like techno
mixing?
No,
it was just you would sign up to join this competition, and then they had five rooms, and they would just invite all these people, and everyone would kind of just go through the rooms, and based on the judges, which they would they appointed Nikki and I the judges, then we would score them based on like programming and presentation, personality. It was actually pretty funny. But then, you know, they would pick the winners, and I was just the guest for that. But that was a lot of fun, because it was a mixture of people who loved music, and there was 300 contestants, I think. It was a lot. And so you also throw in a group of people that are just absolutely nuts over music, and just the vibe was so awesome, because they just appreciated everything that, you know, you do up there, because that's what they're striving to do, right? Mm-hmm. So the energy was good, and that was a really good time. It was called Your Shot. Mm-hmm. That's what that DJ called. I guess they do it all over the world.
I saw you play Ushaya.
Is that how you say it?
I don't know.
Ushaya?
I don't know.
I thought it was Ushuaia.
Probably.
Ushuaia.
But yeah, we stayed there right next to that place when we went to Ibiza. Didn't make it in, but it looked like probably was one of the hottest spots out there. And so I played with Martin Garrix.
Yeah.
That looked like it was pretty, one for the books.
That was one for the books for sure. Yeah, Martin invited me out to play with him, because he had a residency, and that was his closing party at Ushuaia.
Dude, awesome, dude.
So it was sold out, 4,000 people.
Miserable time.
Dude, that was really cool.
What was the weather like? Because when I was out there, it was like, we're from San Diego, and San Diego's got the best weather, but somehow I felt like it was better in Ibiza. I don't know how.
I think it was like San Diego weather. Yeah, it was great. Martin, he's really cool. He is a really, really nice guy. And I'm really grateful that he's like supporting my music and just what I do. And he's bringing, I guess I can just say it. I haven't really officially announced it yet, but we're leading up to it. But he's bringing me to Ultra with him.
You heard it here first, ladies and gentlemen.
There you go. Boom.
He hasn't officially announced it yet, but he just told you right now.
Playing at Ultra this year.
Playing at Ultra this year.
Yeah, Martin Garrix, he's getting his own stage for the label. Yeah. So I'll be joining him.
We got to push this shit live right now, dude. No, I'm just kidding. Well, that's cool. Have you played Ultra before?
I haven't.
That's exciting,
man. Yeah, it's super exciting.
What are the dates?
End of March. So.
Oh, it's coming up.
Yeah, it's coming up.
I think
up.
We should go see you, because now that we're not in San Diego.
Yeah, you're closer
just
now.
Drive down there.
You drive
fly
down there?
Yeah, it's 12 hours. I'd fly, but Miami's always cool. So I haven't been to Ultra in a few years. I think we're overdue. So why don't we just see what the old ball and chain has to say about that, and we'll bring her down there with her ping pong paddle and get you to sign it.
I'm sure she's game.
Yeah, she shout out Green Velvet for signing my wife's ping pong paddle last night. That was cool.
Does she play ping pong?
She does, and she's a beast. She might be a little better at Halo than she is at ping pong, but if anyone wants to challenge her, she will take any challenges at the Victory Sandwich Bar, and I got my money on Joanna. So challenge her. Comment if you're any good at ping pong. You got a show to get to, so we should probably start wrapping it up soon. But I do want to say, like, I wanted to touch on like where people would find you, I guess your music. Where is your favorite format for people to listen to your music? Do you like SoundCloud, or are you just like ditching SoundCloud for Spotify? Because like, what is the climate online kind of look like for someone that has millions of plays like you? Like, where do you like to put your stuff?
I'd say Spotify is the center of focus. I can't say Apple Music. I don't have an Apple Music account, so even though I own a bunch of Apple products.
I sent you a track one time, and I was like, hey, listen to this. You're like, sorry, it's Apple Music. I can't do it.
Can't do it, man. Spotify for life, bro. Yeah. Spotify is it. I mean, I love SoundCloud, but I think, I don't know.
Do you put DJ mixes up anymore?
I should.
I haven't heard a DJ mix from you since the chamber, bro.
I've gotten a lot of requests on that. And I think I need to either start putting up my mixes or put together like a mixtape. I don't want to do like a, you know, like a radio show kind of thing. I feel like being on a schedule is just
tough
for,
okay.
I mean, you got it nailed down, Bert, but with, you know, with what I'm juggling, I feel like it's just, I want to just put together like a mixtape every now and then, or maybe even just live record my shows and just put them up, you know?
Yeah. Pioneer makes a pretty cool app actually for recording now with the DJM Nexus mixers. You can USB directly in and get
Really?
It's Pioneer, or it's DJM-REC, and it does a 96 kilohertz recording of your mix, your master out. You put it in the...
Wait, do you put it on the mixer or on the CDJ?
You put it in the mixer.
In the mixer? Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Yeah, and you can even live stream. It gives you an option to live stream that feed to SoundCloud or Facebook.
Whoa.
While you play.
That's dope.
There you go.
Is this the Nexus 2?
But I think it works on both. It's really just the app. So you just need a 900.
It's an app.
Yeah, it's like $5, I think. So.
Wait, on your phone?
Yep, you just
So you plug your phone into the USB?
Yes.
Oh, so not just a flash drive. You plug the phone in there.
Right, but you don't use the mixer USB for anything. Yeah. That's for like if you want to use an iPad to put effects on.
Yeah, because the mixer can output sound through USB, right. I think, because you can like run Ableton out of the mixer and stuff. Yeah,
yep.
That's pretty cool.
So there you go. So
nice.
So you think Spotify is the way? So
Spotify is the way. You can just look me up, Cazztek, Cazztek. All my socials are that, just at Cazztek.
Sweet.
Pretty simple.
Well, exciting stuff, man. I mean, we got a show to get to. I could literally talk to you for a couple more hours. But yeah. Is there anything you kind of want to like promote or point people to while you're here?
No, I mean, I just say you know, keep on keeping on.
Be nice to people. Any public service announcements you want to?
No PSAs for now.
Okay, cool.
No, just come vibe with me on Spotify.
Yeah, and And thanks for coming to our city. Hopefully we're going to have you back soon. And shout out to all you guys listening. Shout out to our producer, Nick. And everybody. We appreciate it. Thanks.
Everybody.
See ya.
Later.
Peace.